can take indirect both objects, that means direct and indirect object. Only detransitive, D means two. So that means transitive verbs which can give two objects. Like example, like in the example, my dad gave me a gift. See, the actual formation has to be direct object followed by indirect object. But in the first sentence, my dad gave me a gift, what follows what? Actual preposition would have been gift.
That is indirect it. Followed by direct.
Exactly. Indirect followed by direct. Why is it so? So the concept of dative shift explains why the direct object follows indirect object instead of the direct object comes before the indirect object. Look at the sentence. So this is the deep structure. Sita gave a large gift wrapped parcel to her sister. So in that particular sense, it's a deep structure. Okay. Sita gave what? You'll get a large gift wrapped parcel. That is a direct object. To whom? You know that beneficiary or the recipient as the indirect object. So if you ask the question what to the verb, you'll get the object. So if you ask the question what to verb, you'll get the direct object. Sita gave what? A large gift wrapped parcel. That is a direct object. And to whom? If you ask the question to whom, you will get the recipient or the beneficiary. It is here. To her sister. But we usually say it as Sita gave her sister a large gift wrapped parcel. That is another way of saying the same sentence. Isn't it so?
Yes.
Yes. So this process is called a dative shift. That means you remove the preposition and you raise the indirect object to a position before the direct object. This process is called a dative shift. Dative case means indirect object case. You are raising the indirect object to a position after the verb. That is why it is called a dative shift through preposition deletion. Okay? The shifting of an indirect object to a position after the verb is termed a dative shift. It is done through preposition deletion. My dad gave a gift to me. Okay? That is the correct sentence. That is a deep structure. From that, I can also derive a surface structure like my dad gave me a gift. That is done through dative shift. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Dative means it's an adjective for the word indirect. Another word for indirect object is dative case. So I hope it's clear to you. Shall I move on?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now we will see prepositional object. Already we saw what is a prepositional object. Usually an object introduced by preposition is called a prepositional object. Again, we have seen the case of case of indirect object introduced by preposition as an example. He gave a gift to me. Doesn't mean that all objects are indirect objects. All objects which are introduced with the preposition are indirect object. There are some exceptions. Look at these examples. I am going to my workplace. Put the flowers in the flower vase. Are they really indirect objects? I'm going to my workplace. Rather, they act like adverbial clause, right? I'm going to where? Where are you going? Here, it's not indirect object. Rather, it acts like a adverbial clause. The prepositional clause acts like a adverbial clause. In the two examples, I'm going to my workplace. Where are you going? Put the flowers in the flower vase. Where should I put the flowers? In the flower vase. Again, you get a noun phrase being introduced with a preposition to in the first sentence and in the second sentence. But they are not indirect object. Rather, they are noun phrases which act like an adverb. Isn't it so?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, there is another expression that is also a prepositional object that we have seen, the WH movement or WH transformation. Do you remember that? With what you cut onion, with which you cut the onion, or with what you cut onion. So in that case, you take the WH element from the deep structure itself, and it is called a WH trace, if you recall. Do you remember that WH trace and WH movement? When you make WH questions, you get the WH expression from the sentence itself. But when it comes as a surf, when it comes out of the deep structure, you usually leave only a trace which is not visible, and that trace is expressed using the small t. Remember that?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So when you take the WH expression from the sentence, you usually leave the preposition all stranded by itself. That is why you get expressions like whom are you waiting for. The deep structure was you are waiting for whom. So when you move the WH, you simply leave the preposition there. So the for, the preposition for will remain there. That's why we have expressions like whom are you waiting for. It is actually a prepositional object. So whom was a prepositional object? Okay, clear? Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, moving on. Again, we have discussed the cases, different cases, mainly four types of cases: nominative case, genitive case, accusative case. Accusative cases can be of two types. That's why I have different four types: nominative, accusative, and we don't have this four type classification now. Earlier we had this four type classification: nominative, dative, accusative, and genitive. I hope you remember the four cases in case of Old English, the four level classification based on cases in Old English. They had all the four cases: nominative case, dative case, accusative case, genitive case. You remember that?
Yes, ma'am.
We have these classifications. Yeah. Exactly. In block 2, history of language. So, even though we have the four or three cases mainly, all nouns do not show these cases. Only pronouns show all these three cases. Nouns do not show the cases except in the case of genitive one, because in case of a possessive noun, you will usually put an apostrophe followed by s. So that is the only way a noun is inflected to show case. Okay. Usually pronouns show these cases. Nouns do not show the cases except for genitive case. They inflect only for genitive case. Inflect only to show genitive case or possessive case. This is Ram's garden. Ram apostrophe s. In no other position, they do not. In no other position, they do not any change. Be it subject or object, the noun remains the same. I saw Ram. Ram saw me. In the first case, Ram is the object. In the second case, Ram is the subject. But Ram doesn't show any change. But in the case, if it comes as a possessive noun, it shows change. This is Ram's house. There you put apostrophe to show that it is a possessive noun. Okay. Okay, clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now we will see indirect object or dative case. Usually it is the beneficiary of an action. Again, we have seen this. Only do transitive verbs take an indirect object. An example is, if you can recall dative shift, you will see that Sita gave her sister a large gift wrapped parcel. That is made through dative shift. The original sentence, the deep structure was, Sita gave a large gift wrapped parcel to her sister. That was the deep structure. From that, you derived another sentence, Sita gave her sister a large gift wrapped parcel through dative shift. Now, this I have already explained. Why? Explains why indirect object precedes a direct object. A deletion transformation erases preposition. Now, we are moving on to a very important theory, which is known as case theory. So first of all, we need to know what is a case. That we have already seen what is a case. Each of the noun or noun phrase will be assigned a case in a sentence. So it must have a case. You can't have a sentence without a noun being assigned a case. Every noun phrase in a sentence must be assigned a case. Be it nominative case, be it accusative case, be it any case, but only thing is that every noun phrase must bear a case in a sentence. That is what the case theory says. Again, a noun phrase is ungrammatical in the language if it doesn't have a syntactic case. So every noun phrase should be assigned a case. If it is subject, you will give the case nominative. If it is object, you give the case accusative. Okay? If it is used to show possession, you give the case genitive. Okay? Again, you will see that there are some case assigners in the sentence. And the most important case assigner is in a sentence is the verb. For example, when a noun phrase precedes a verb, you will see that the noun phrase gets nominative case. When the noun phrase succeeds the verb, you will see that it gets the objective case or accusative case. Isn't it so?
Yes, ma'am.
So we'll understand that the verb is the most important case assigner. So this special kind of relationship is called the government. Okay, again, just like how a verb gives case to the noun phrase, you have different kind of relationship exist in a sentence. And this relationship is called a government. That means the head of a phrase governs its complement. If it is noun phrase, you have seen that X bar theory. Then first was phrase structure theory. Then he came up with something called TG grammar. Along with that, he introduced something called X bar theory. So there he said that, there Chomsky said that the head of a syntactic phrase must be the corresponding part of speech. If it is a noun phrase, the head must be a noun. If it is a verb phrase, the head must be a verb. Do you remember that?
Yes, ma'am.
Again, here we say that the head of a phrase governs its complement. Again, it's specified as well. If you are using definite article, again, a or an, you will see that it is governed by the subject or the noun. So whatever is the head of the phrase, it governs the other elements in that phrase. Again, here we should remember the C command. That is why we have examples where verb is commanding, C commanding the preposition. Or preposition is C commanding the noun phrase. So all these can be explained using the concept of C command that we already discussed. Okay. There we saw on niece relationship. Do you remember C command? I hope you remember it.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, case and noun phrase movement. Again, as you have seen that case, you can't have a sentence without a noun phrase being assigned a case. So case plays a very important role. Another movement called a WH movement. Again, apart from WH movement, it also plays a very important noun phrase movement. That especially comes in passivization transformation. Again, you will see that the noun phrase is moved to the subject position and the noun phrase in the subject position is moved to the object position. That is an example for a noun phrase movement. See, look at the sentence, the mangoes were eaten by the children. What happens is the noun phrase movement, because the mangoes, the object mangoes will be moved to the subject position. Okay. So that is derived from the deep structure representation, as you can see from the example. So this is the first one is the deep structure representation. That means the subject plus be eaten plus the mangoes. Mangoes is the object there. Look at the second sentence. The mangoes were dashed by the children. So that is the surface level representation. There we see that it is the noun phrase transformation or noun phrase movement has happened. Okay. Clear? Again?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
You will see that just like WH transformation. WH transformation also, we will see that WH is taken to the position of the subject. So that is again a noun phrase movement. Second important noun phrase movement is passivization transformation. Third important is subject to subject raising. Sometimes you will have a dummy subject for the main clause. In that case, you will usually move or you'll apply the subject of the subordinate clause or the other clause to the main clause also. Look at the first example. It seems Ram is exhausted. And look at the first sentence. It seems, thereby you should see that it is used as a dummy pronoun there. It is actually a pronoun. It is actually a pronoun, but here it works like a dummy pronoun. Does it really stand for something? The first example,
no,
seems no. So it is a dummy, isn't it so? So here I am moving Ram. Ram is the subject of the other clause. It seems Ram is exhausted. So I am taking that, it seems that there has to be that Ram, it is left. But I am taking that Ram, I am moving that Ram to to the subject position. So what happens is that Ram seems to be exhausted. So that means the second inflectional phrase, that is Ram is exhausted, will have only the trace of the subject. TX means the trace of Ram. Because Ram is moved to the subject position of the main clause. Now what is left is the trace. Since I have taken the tense also with Ram, because Ram plus, again, it is a present tense form. So when I took Ram, the control, the governor verb has also to be taken. So in order to show present tense, we have seems in the main clause. So when that Ram is moved to the subject position, what is left is just a trace. That is why inflectional phrase will be turned into a non-finite clause. That is why it is to be exhausted. To be exhausted means what is left behind us only is. It's a be form. Isn't it be form? Is a be form. Is a be verb. Hello?
Yes,
yes ma'am.
Okay, then again, the inflection element is also taken along with Ram, because Ram is the one who seems to be exhausted. So verb is also moved. What is left is only the be form. That is also non-finite form. We don't know what is the subject there. So only the trace is there. So we don't have, we can't have the verb controlling a trace. That is why it is turned into a non-finite form. If it is, it has to control the noun phrase. Since there is no noun phrase, only the trace, it can't be controlled by the verb form is. So it turns into a non-finite form. That's why we have Ram seems, that is the main clause, and to be exhausted is the non-finite subordinate clause. Earlier it was a non-finite, it was a non-finite, rather it was a finite subordinate clause. Now it has turned into a non-finite subordinate clause. Isn't it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, this is called a subject-to-subject tracing. Subject Ram is the subject of the subordinate clause. From there, I am taking Ram into the position of the subject of the main clause. Just because it is dummy, it can happen. It can be applied only if the subject of the main clause is not the real subject. Okay. Then, exceptional case marking. Sorry?
Case filter. What is case filter? What do you mean by case filter?
Case filter is the filter that we use to show case. See, case filter is the filter. That means if you are using present tense, you are using a filter for a present tense. Okay. Then, see, case filter is not the important part there. It is the case movement, and that means case theory, case assignment and case theory. It is using case filter that we apply case. Okay? Then exceptional case marking. Again, we have seen this. See, if the second clause or if the subordinate clause is a non-finite clause, it can't usually take a subject. Only a finite verb can assign case to a subject. Okay, don't forget that. In case theory, the important thing is that only a finite verb can assign case to a subject or object. In order to give case, it has to be a finite verb. So look at the first sentence. My mother wants me to go to the market. The subordinate clause, that is the second one, to go to the market, is not a finite clause. Then how can it give case? Can it give case? Because to go is a non-finite. It can't give case to the subject. So what happens is that the object of the main clause becomes the subject of the subordinate clause, because already the verb want, the verb of the main clause want, is a finite clause. It has already given the objective case, that is the accusative case. Is it clear? Because when a noun phrase or a noun comes after the verb, it usually gets accusative case. Okay? If it comes before the verb, it is nominative case. And if it comes after the verb, it is accusative case. So let us take the main clause. My mother wants me. So me is an accusative case, because the verb want has already given it an accusative case, because it follows the verb. We have seen that verb is the most important case assigner. So want can give accusative case to the pronoun I. So I becomes me. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Then again, if you take the second sentence, to go to the market, since it's a non-finite sentence, it can't take a subject of its own. Because go, the verb go, since it's non-finite, it can't assign nominative case to the subject. Can it? Because go is a non-finite form. So because it is preceded by to, to is a non-finite. To plus verb form is a non-finite. So to go can't give nominative case to the subject. So what happens is the objective case, that is me, or accusative case me, will be applied to the subordinate clause also. That's why we have a construction like my mother wants me to go to the market, because me becomes the object of the first sentence and also the subject of the subordinate clause. It is me because it is the verb of the finite clause which has assigned the case to the object. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
This is called exceptional case marking. Look at the second sentence. Harish believes himself to be intelligent. Again, what is the object here? Subject is Harish. And what is the object here? I saw myself. So what is the object? The object is Harish himself, right? When the action is reflected back to the subject, we usually use reflective pronoun. Okay? When the subject becomes the object, we don't use the accusative form, rather we use the reflective form. I saw myself, he did it himself. They saw themselves, we saw ourselves, you do it yourself. Because the subject and object are the same. When you have the subject acting as the object, you can't use the accusative form, rather you have to use the reflective form. Isn't it the rule?
Yes, ma'am.
Harish is the object here. The verb assigns reflective case. That means accusative. When it, the subject comes as the object, you usually have the reflective form. So in the second sentence, himself is the object here. And it has a reflective, it is a reflective pronoun. So naturally, believes has given the verb, that is a finite verb. Because believes is a finite verb, it shows tense, believes, that is present tense. So it can assign case to the subject. So that case comes to be applicable to the subordinate clause also. That is to be intelligent. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So this is called exceptional case marking. Exceptional case marking occurs when the subordinate clause is a non-finite clause. Because the verb of a non-finite clause cannot assign case to the subject. Only a finite verb can assign case to the subject. If it's a finite verb, it can give a nominative or accusative case to the subject or the object or the noun phrase or the noun or a pronoun. But in case, if it is a non-finite verb, it can't assign case to the noun. So rather, it takes case from the finite verb of the main clause. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
This is called exceptional case marking. So example, my mother wants, this is how you represent it. Look at the phrase, inflectional phrase one. My mother wants me to inflectional phrase two. Inflectional phrase, you know, just take it as subordinate clause. Me to go to the market, the infinitive verb. So it gets its case from the finite verb of the main clause. The next important is theta theory. So earlier we saw case theory. Now this is theta theory. We are discussing the cases related to the noun phrase. Now we are going to see the roles of the noun phrase. Okay. So earlier we saw that every noun phrase must be assigned a case. Just like that, every noun phrase must be assigned a proper theme also. Okay.
Okay.
So that means it is based on a criterion called the theta criterion. That means every argument noun phrase in a sentence bears one and only one theta role, one T. And each theta role is assigned to one and only one argument. If it is a doer of the action, it has to be assigned a T, doer. If it is a, that means doer and recipient can't be carrying the same T. The recipient can't be the doer. Clear?
Yes.
Okay, but in reflective case, if I say that he killed Kim himself, there also you see that the role has changed. Here, both, even though both belong to the same person, both mean the same person, they have different theta roles. They have different roles. One is the recipient and the other one is the beneficiary or the patient. One is the doer of the action, and the other one is the patient.
Okay? Yes, okay.
This is called a theta theory. Again, this part of generative grammar that deals with thematic roles. Every, just like case theory, every noun phrase must be assigned a proper T. Look at the relation between thematic roles and case. Usually, nominative case, the noun phrase which bears nominative case would be an agent or experiencer. Okay. Similarly, a noun phrase in the accusative case will be a patient. I saw him. I is the agent. Okay. Then team is him. He is the patient. Patient doesn't mean the literal patient, rather the one who is the beneficiary or patient. Okay. So this usually, this is the connection. A nominative case usually bears the role of an agent or experiencer, while an accusative case usually bears the thematic role of team or patient. Okay, sometimes an argument is the opposite of preposition. Again, the object of a preposition will always bear the role of location. The book is on the table. It tells us about the location. Okay, he is in the garden. Okay, again, that is just a role. Exceptions are also there. Look at the exceptions. They often like amusing toys. Look at the first one, experiencer. The when you convert it into passive voice also, you will get the subject and object bearing the same function of experiencer. Again, there is another exception. Similarly, the same case is often assigned to argument noun phrases with two different theta roles. In the first example, the children as an experiencer. And the second example, the children threw stones at them. They are the agent. Sometimes, the same noun phrase can bear different theta roles. Okay. The first example, children is experiencer. In the second example, it is the agent. The children is the agent. So same case or the noun phrase which take the same case can bear different theta roles, but not in the same sentence, but in a different sentence. I hope it's clear to you.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now inflectional element. It is inflection, tense. Okay, again, INFL, we can denote this inflectional element using the term INFL. So inflectional categories can be, doesn't always need to be about tense, can also show aspect, mode, and person and number. That's why in the earlier examples of exceptional case marking, that inflectional phrase, even though it doesn't show tense, I use the term inflectional phrase too. That means it showed the mode or aspect. Okay. Because when you use ing form, it shows the aspect. The action is in progression. That's an aspect. So using the term INFL, you can not only show tense, you can also show aspect, mode, person, and number. Okay? So again, INFL, inflection can replace a distinct constituent like a modal auxiliary. Look at the sentence. She meets him every day. She can meet him every day. The first sentence is a simple present tense. The same syntactic element, syntactic constant. I hope you can, I hope you remember syntactic constant. What is a syntactic constant?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So look at the first example. She meets him every day. So the verb is meets. So that syntactic constant can be replaced with another syntactic constant. That is the rule of, we have discussed the five tests.
Yes, ma'am.
Substitution. Do you remember that? Yes, it is substitution. Yes, so if you can meet a syntactic constituent with another syntactic constituent, it is called a substitution. See, this meets as a verb phrase or verb, it can be replaced with a modal, again another verb phrase, but which is a combination of a modal plus a verb. Modal means it's a special can type of auxiliary. Can, may, might, they're all modal auxiliaries. So inflection can replace it, because you can't say that meets is simple present, so I can replace only with another tense, another verb which shows tense. Here can meet, it's not about tense, it is about ability, some special model, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So we have seen that it is distinct syntactic constituent. It is not related to present tense. It doesn't show tense at all, because it shows ability. It is not about time. It is rather about ability. But in the first sentence, she meets him, it is about time. It is present tense. But that means INFL can replace a distinct syntactic constituent. Sometimes it doesn't even need to be a full word. It occurs as a suffix, like S or ES or S, arm, R. They're all suffixes, especially that S form. It's a suffix. It doesn't always need to be a verb. So that means inflection, that INFL can be denoted using ING form, can be denoted using S form, ED form. That all can be used to show INFL. Because when you use ING form, it means it is showing aspect. That means it is progression. If you use EN form, that shows completion, or V3. Sometimes you use S form along with third person singular. It shows present tense. Okay? So that means INFL doesn't always need to be a full word. Then often we use do to support the inflectional element. Sometimes you won't find that do. Only when you make questions or negatives that you will use that do. I see him. The negative is I don't see him. Or the question is, do I see him? So when you use do to support the inflectional element, you call it do support. In order to make questions, in order to make negative, we recall that do. Or we use that do. So that is called a do support. It doesn't always need to be do, does, did. Whenever you use did, does, or do to bring about a change in the sentence, it is called a do support. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, what's the need of it?
That shows tense. See, when you want to make a question in present tense, she sings. Does she sing? That is a question, because does is used to show tense, present tense. Did is used to show past tense.
Ma'am, she meets, then what's the need? She can meet like that.
See, the question is not what is the need. The question is, I can also do it that way. Because meet, the verb meet shows tense. Sometimes it can be replaced with a syntactic constituent which doesn't necessarily perform that particular function. Here meets perform the function. Here meet is a combination of meet plus does. It shows due support. So it shows tense. But in the second sentence, can meet. Again, that is another sentence which I have derived out of the other sentence, but not to show tense, rather to show ability. I have used a modal auxiliary, can.
Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
I can also do it that way. It doesn't always need to replace a syntactic constituent of the same category. See, if I replace meets with he, if I replace meets with met, it shows both of the verb show tense. Both of them belong to the same category. But I was telling you that I can also use a distinct syntactic constituent. Because can meet belongs to a distinct syntactic constituent. It's a distinct syntactic constituent. It belongs to a category called the modals. Can meet, may meet, might meet. None of those verb phrases show tense. Do they?
Yes, ma'am.
Is the idea clear?
Yes, ma'am.
I was telling you that INFL doesn't always need to replace a syntactic constituent belonging to the same category. I can also have it, but it should be a syntactic constituent. That is the only thing. Like a verb. That means it can replace a verb. It should be something related to verb. That's why I have used can meet. I can't use a noun phrase there, because that is that is used to replace a verb. So that should at least function like a verb.
That means can meet can be a syntactic constituent.
It is a syntactic constituent.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Even though it is a distinct syntactic constituent. That is why I've told you that in the first example, it shows tense. Meets him every day. It shows tense. The second example, it is not showing any tense. Because there, I'm telling about ability. But in other sense, I can also use can to denote tense. Like can is ability, but we have a past form. It is could. But only if I use could that, it shows tense. Otherwise, can doesn't show any tense at all. The past form of can shows tense. Similarly, past form of will would. But both of them at the same time, you can't call them as past tense because we use could and would to denote present, denote not request or polite request. Could I meet him? Okay. I hope it's clear. So when you use do, does, or did to support the verb, it is called do support. You are inserting a verb. You are inserting an auxiliary like do. Did you meet him? Do you meet him? Then you are using do support because when you ask the question, did you meet him? It shows tense. Again, do you meet him? And I've used do to show tense. So this kind of insertions are called do support. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Moving on. Affix hobby. Again, I've told you that the head of the clause is INFL. Or the if it is a verb, you will see that mainly. If it is a sentence, you will see that the head of the clause is IM. That is the inflectional element. Maybe aspect. Because the non-finite, the head of a non-finite clause might be ing form or might be to form, to plus verb combination. Okay? So, and the verb phrase occurs its complement to the right of it. For example, I am doing it. So, the inflection is am because am shows the tense. And the verb phrase doing it comes after the inflection. Okay? But there are certain words whereby you will see that, especially in the case of do or does, you will see that the inflectional element, even though precedes the head of the verb, it comes after the verb. Because you get the combination meets as a result of the combination of does plus meet. Isn't it so? I met him. It's a combination of met is the combination of did plus meet. That's why when you make the question is, did you meet him? When you combine did with meet, that it becomes met. Okay. So the inflection usually that INFL element, INFL element actually occurs before the verb phrase. Okay. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
But when you express it, normally it comes after the verb. That is why we have examples like she sings a song. She sings a song. She sings songs. She dances well. The combination is she, after she used des plus dances, dances. But if you look at the combination is IFNL plus verb. That is des plus verb. But the final product is sings. That means the inflectional element comes after the verb. Okay? So this happens due to a process or transformational rule called affix hopping. That means this is actually operation in which you can see that the morphological or inflectional element, that means S or ES, that the inflectional element hops over a verb. Be it a main verb or auxiliary, it comes after the verb. This is called affix hopping. The inflectional element comes after the verb, even though it would have been. Hello, coming before the verb. Is it clear? Normally, inflection precedes a verb. Again, I'm telling you, inflection precedes a verb. So, but in expression, you will see that normally. Inflection takes place after the verb. Sing plus ing is singing. But the process is aspect plus singer singing. That means continuous plus singer singing. Isn't it so? If you are applying the aspect of progression to a verb, that you will get the product singing.
Yes, ma'am.
But when you express it, you will see that the IFNL element comes after the verb. This process is called affix hopping. That means IFNL element is found to be suffixed to the verb root. That means sing becomes singing, even though IFNL is added before the verb. This process is called affix hopping, whereby you will see that the IFNL element hops over a verb. Okay. Again, auxiliary verb means being, having. In that case also, we will see the doing. They are all auxiliaries. Be it a main verb or auxiliary, normally, IFNL element inflection is applied before the verb, but when it is expressed, it comes after the verb. This process is called affix hopping. I hope it's clear to you.
Can you please give another example also? One more example.
These are all examples. For a main verb, the examples are sings, singing, sung. All these are examples. If you take the main verb, sing, when you want to make it into simple present tense, you apply des plus sing, then it becomes sings. If you are adding ing, you will the combination is present continuous plus sing as singing. Similarly, if it is past participle, you will get the combination en plus sing is sung, v3 plus sing is sung. Okay. Again, if you are taking an auxiliary word like be as an example, be is, am, are, was, where, all those come under the term be verbs. If it is a be verb, you will see that being is being. Again, if it is have, it is having or had. All these are examples for affix hopping. Okay. Shall I move on to the next PPT?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, to the next speech. Tense and finiteness. Again, you will see that all these are finite tenses, right? Ram walked 5 kilometers yesterday. You will again take the example walked. The combination is past tense. ED plus walked is walked. Past plus walk is walked. Again, you will see that it is suffix hoping because ED is added to the main verb. It is added to the root, that is walk. Then you get the expression walked. This is affix hoping because even though you have added or even though the IFNL element comes before the verb, the expression is in expression, it comes after the verb walked.
Yes, ma'am.
This is suffix hoping. Again, walks 5 kilometers every day. The first tense is past, simple past. Second is simple present. And third one is future. Okay, but in future, we don't have any form for verb for the future. Rather, we use auxiliaries like will or shall to denote future. But basically, we have only two tense forms, that is present tense and past tense. Future tense will be expressed using the help of auxiliaries like will or shall. Then, now we are going to see tense as a case assigner. We have seen that verb can assign case. Do you remember that? In case theory, we have seen that verb is a very important case assigner. It gives nominative and objective and possessive case to the noun phrase. Okay. And we have also seen that only finite clause can assign case. Non-finite cannot assign case to the subject or object. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
And we are going to see how tense assigns case to the subject or tense assigns case to a noun phrase. So we had this idea that it is the verb which assigns case. Now we will see that it is not the verb, rather it is the tense which assigns case in case of that is why we have only finite verbs giving case to the noun phrase. That is because it shows tense. So we can better say that it is not the verb, rather it is the tense which assigns case. That's why non-finite clauses or non-finite verbs cannot assign case. So now we are going to see another relation which is called M command. Earlier we saw C command. Now we are going to see a broader idea than C command, which is M command. So here I look at the definition. A node X M commands another node Y if and only if the lowest maximal projection dominating X also dominates Y, and neither X dominates Y nor vice versa. I'll explain it using this example. Look at the sentence. He teaches the children. So the inflectional phrase is the maximal projection that dominates both noun phrase one and inflectional element. So IP here is the whole sentence. He teaches the children is the IP. Okay, because it dominates both the noun phrase and both the inflectional phrase. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Now here we will see that the noun phrase one is he, then teaches the children is the inflectional phrase, because the inflection des is I and verb phrase is teach plus noun phrase two. We didn't include that I element earlier. We have divided only it as verb phrase. Now we have seen the new element IFNL, which comes before the verb. So we have another intermediate division, that is inflectional phrase. That inflectional phrase is I and VP. Okay, inflectional branch is I and VP, isn't it? So I is the teacher's children, that is inflectional element, teaches the children. There we have I is des. Des plus teach is teachers. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Here?
Now we are going to see the relationship between NP1 and this I. So the relationship between this I and NP1 is called M command. Earlier we saw the relationship between like V and I. That was C command. Now we are going to see the relationship between I and noun phrase 1. So it is through M command that I assigns case to noun phrase. M command means they should come from the same branch. Maximal projection should be same. Here the maximal projection is IP1. Look at the definition. A node X M commands another node Y. That means the node I. You should remember that X is I. Take that I for X. The inflection M, inflection I, M commands another node noun phrase. Okay, node I, M commands NP. Clear? Here it is he. Inflection des. Here the inflection is inflectional. From that inflectional phrase, you get the inflection as des. He teaches me. He teaches grammar. In that example, you will get des as the inflection. So here it says that a node X M commands another node Y. That means here S X stands for I and Y stands for noun. Look at the example. Here I is the X and NP is Y. Clear? Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Then
yes,
ma'am. Now we will see that I M commands NP1. I can M command NP1. That means X can M command NP1. That is Y. If and only if the lowest maximal projection dominating X also dominates Y, and neither X dominates Y nor vice versa. Both of them come from the same projection, maximal projection, that is IP. If they come from the same IP, that Y X can dominate Y. Here Y is the noun phrase and I is the X. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Is the idea clear to you? Is the concept of M command clear to you? Here, who is commanding noun phrase then? Who is commanding noun phrase? What is commanding noun phrase here better? Hello?
He.
I'm the...
Is he commanding I or I commanding he?
I command.
It is because X stands for yes, I. Yes. NP1 stands for Y. So both of them come from the same maximal projection IP. So M command says that if both of them come from, if X and Y come from the same maximal projection, lowest maximal projection, here it is IP, this X can M command Y. Here X stands for I, inflection des, and NP stands for key. Is it clear now? Is it clear now? Here we can say that the niece is commanding the aunt. Earlier, C command, we saw that the aunt is commanding niece. Here, the niece is commanding aunt. That is M command. Okay? Because both of them come from the same mother branch, IP. And inflection is I. That is a daughter of I. I dash, which is a sister to NP1. So here we see that the niece is, just remember like this, the niece is commanding the aunt. This relation is known as M command. While when you see that aunt is commanding the niece, it is C command. Okay. The only difference is that the sentence will be taken. Taken halt. The whole sentence will be taken as the inflectional phrase because it's a clause. The whole sentence will be taken as an inflectional phrase. Then only this M commanding is possible. In the other case, we were dividing the sentence into two branches. It is from the second branch that we had this C command. Okay, but here this the whole sentence will be taken as the maximal projection. Okay. I hope it's clear to you.
Yes, ma'am.
So now we will see that. Now we understood that it is not the verb which is assigning the case, but it is the inflection which assigns the case. So it is the third person singular, that is des, is assigning nominative case to he. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, moving on to aspect and tense. I've told you that aspect is not about time. It is about the status of completion or progression. So in order to show completion, we use V3. And in order to show progression, we use ing form. Okay. Again, we have three. Mainly, we have three aspects. Simple or definite aspect that shows something which is part of our everyday life. Then perfect aspect and the progressive aspect. But simple indefinite aspect is that comes under a finite category, while the perfect aspect and the progressive or continuous aspect come under the non-finite. Okay, even though we have three aspects, only one is finite, the other two are non-finite. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
But non-finite cannot assign, we have already discussed this, non-finite cannot assign any case to the noun phrase because it's non-finite. That means second and third one, the progressive and perfect aspect, cannot assign any case because they are non-finite. In case of the first one also, it is not the aspect, rather it is the inflection element that gives assigns case. Now agreement. Again, we have seen that there are different types of agreements. It is called concord. That is agreement between the subject and the verb. So different patterns of agreement exist for different languages. And one such is ergativity, which is not applicable to English. Even transitive verbs marks agreement with the subject. If it's a transitive verb, we have seen that transitive verb controls object, but here transitive verbs can even influence the subject. Such kind of agreement is called ergativity, which is not applicable to English. Here in English, verb is marked for agreement with the subject for the third person singular present. Isn't it so? Only in the third person singular present that we show this agreement. If it is third person singular, for example, he or she, we use S along with the verb. Only for third person singular present that English verb show agreement. This agreement is visible rather. In all other cases, we can't see the agreement, even though there existed agreement. The verb doesn't change to show agreement. In other cases, like a third person plural, second person singular and plural, first person singular and plural. In all these cases, you won't find any agreement in a visible form. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Again, agreement is a component of the verbal inflection element INFL. Agreement, again, you use S form along with the verb to denote third person singular. It's part of INFL. I've told you that IFNL is not just about tense, it is about agreement, mode, and so on. Again, you will see that agreement can also ascend case just like INFL. Like tense, agreement also possesses the ability to ascend case through the co-indexing of agreement with the relevant noun phrase. If it's the case of third person singular, you will understand that it can ascend case to it. So, but it is not clear. Except this third person singular, we don't have other examples to show in English. So agreement occurs only as part of the inflectional element of finite clauses. Again, only finite clauses can show agreement. It can also only they can show tense, they can only show agreement. And in case of English, only third person singular or singular verb shows agreement. So, but in case if you are taking agreement as a part of universal grammar, it is separated with a distinct functional head as AGRP. That means it has got its own maximal projection in the case of I dash. Earlier, we saw that I dash, inflectional phrase, I dash. That is a maximal projection. But in case of other languages, you have this projection called AGRP. Because they have different types of agreement, as in the case of ergativity. The transitive verb can agree with the subject. Sometimes a first person singular verb can show agreement. Sometimes second person, then each of the verb tense forms can show agreement. But in case of English, only third person singular shows this agreement. Okay. Usually, this subject is assigned nominative case through AGR. Because when a noun comes before the agreement element, of course, it gets the nominative position. It gets a nominative case, not position. It gets a nominative case. Okay? This is not that explicit in case of English. That's why I told you that it comes only in the case of third person singular. In no other forms, this agreement is visible. But in other languages, it is very important, and that's why we treat AGR as a separate projection with the name AGRP. Shall we move on?
Yes, ma'am.
Now we are going to see anaphora. Do you remember the concept of anaphora?
Yes, ma'am.
What is anaphora?
Anaphora can replace
substitution.
Very good. To avoid repetition, you
constant, like you are something noun phrase.
Very good. Very good.
Verb phrase.
Again, you use pronouns to replace a noun phrase and do so to replace a verb phrase. That means it doesn't have any independent reference of its own. It has to refer. It has to depend on the main clause to get its reference. So that means it should have an antecedent. In the case of noun phrase. In case of a pronoun, it should have an antecedent, should have a noun phrase. Reference again borrowed from the reference of some other expression. Either there should be a reference within the sentence, at least there should be a reference outside the context which the listener understands. Otherwise, you can't use pronoun he. If you are using he, that means the person who are listening should understand who this he is, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So that means they are borrowed expressions. Again, pronouns and reflexes are seen. Sita said that she was hungry. Look at the sentence. Sita said that she was angry. Sita said, again, it's a main clause. That she was angry is a subordinate clause. I have used she to replace Sita. And the context is again, you will understand that she refers to Sita because it has an antecedent, Sita. Ram hurt himself. Himself refers to whom?
Ram.
Again, you understand the context because it has an antecedent. The first sentence, there are two sentences. Second, the reference of the subject of the second clause takes the subject of the first clause as its antecedent. But in the second case, there is only one sentence. And there also, the object takes the subject as its antecedent. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, reference and co-indexing. There can be two types of reference. One is identity of sense and the other one is identity of reference. Sense means it is strict identity. That means it refers to the same kind of individual. See, this little boy is naughtier than that one. That one means, that one is an anaphora. That means, who is that one? Another little boy. This little boy is naughtier than that one. That refer to the same kind of individual. Look at the second sentence. It is called a slopey identity because often it can be ambiguous. John loves his wife, so does Bill. So whom does Bill love?
His wife. Can be
John's wife or his wife, right? Both can be the interpretations. John loves his wife, so does Bill. Bill also loves John's wife. That is one interpretation. Or can also, we can also say that Bill loves his own wife.
Yes, ma'am.
So this is called identity of reference. It refers to the same individual. So if you take the first interpretation as the interpretation of this particular sentence, you will say that it is identity of reference. Both refer to the same individual. That means both John and Bill loves John's wife. That is identity of reference. If you are referring Bill's wife, you are using identity of sense. That means both refer to the same kind of individual. John loves yes, his yes, wife, ma'am. Bill loves his wife, his own wife. Okay. Yes. So first case is identity of reference, and the second case is identity of sense. Identity of sense is strict identity, while the other one is loopy because they are confused. You can't make sure whom does he refer to. Whom does this particular phrase refer to? Moving on, a very important theory, binding theory. It's easy, but when you read the principle, it might sound confusing, but it's a very easy theory. Consists mainly, we have three principles coming under binding theory. First one is, an anapher must be bound in its local domain. Anapher, you have seen what are anapher, something which can replace something as an anapher. Second is, a pronominal must be free in its local domain. Principle C is, a referential expression must be free everywhere. Let's take the first one first. Before that, you should know what is a local domain. Okay, so what is a local domain? That means local domain for a syntactic constituent is the minimal or IP, inflectional phrase dominating X, the governor of X, and a potential antecedent of X. So look at the word herself. What is the local domain for herself? Does not, despise is the local domain. Okay, it is a, because it's a, it is the minimal inflectional phrase dominating noun phrase, the sida. Okay. So local domain for herself is the IP.
Yes,
IP. Does not despise is the local domain. Again, you will see that sida is the antecedent. Does not despise is the local domain. Because both come under, both belong to the same inflectional phrase. The local domain for sida is does not despise. Just like that, the local domain for herself is also does not despise, because both come under the same inflectional phrase. Is the idea clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So that inflectional phrase will be the governor of X. Does not despise is the governor of X. So that is also the antecedent of X. So the subject of the IP will be the antecedent of herself. So the antecedent of herself here is Sita. That is the noun phrase which comes under the same inflectional phrase. So that is the antecedent. Because the syntactic constituent is herself, it is a pronoun. Again, Sita is another noun phrase. So both are syntactic constituent of the same category, noun or noun phrase. So you will see that herself has the antecedent Sita in the same local domain because it's an inflectional phrase. Okay, clear. So according to principle A of binding theory, anapher must be bound in its local domain. Now we are going to see the anapher.
Ma'am, some voice disturbances are going on.
I don't know from where.
Ma'am, please ask Ishita to mute her mic.
See, I don't think I can mute.
She muted.
Okay. Now we will discuss principle A of binding theory. What was the principle A? An anapher must be bound to its local domain. It must be bound to its local domain. That means it have a potential antecedent in the local domain itself. Let us take the concept of anaphers first. Under anaphers, we have reflexives, relative pronouns, and emphatic pronouns. First, we will see reflexive. You know what are reflexive? Reflexive pronouns are?
Himself, herself.
Pronouns which reflect back to the subject. Like myself, ourselves, yourself, they're all reflexive pronouns. And again, it must agree in person, number, and gender with the antecedent noun phrase closest to it. Look at this. Let us take the example. See, they accidentally hurt himself. Can we say himself?
No,
because the IP here is accidentally hurt, and the antecedent there is Sita. So the reflexive must be bound to its local domain. That means the reflect must be in agreement with the number, gender, and person of the antecedent. So in order to reflect Sita, you can use only herself, not himself. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Again, look at the second example. I want Mary to behave herself. Again, you can't use myself, which is the correct one. I want Mary to behave. Myself is
herself.
Local domain there. Which is the local domain for the reflexive pronoun there? Is it I? Is it I want or Mary to behave? Behave is the right. So Mary is the subject of the second clause. So Mary will be the antecedent. Mary is the antecedent of
herself.
The reflective. So it is not myself, it is herself. Mary feels that John is not sure about himself. Again, you will get the second clause. Inflectional phrases, John is not sure about himself or ourselves. It is himself because John is the antecedent in that clause. So it should be himself, not ourselves. So the first principle of binding theory says that an anapher must be bound to its local domain. So we have seen the first class of anaphers. The first class of anaphers are reflexive. So reflexive pronouns must be bound to its local domain. So it must have an antecedent within the local domain. And that reflexive pronoun must agree number, person, and gender to the antecedent. Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
But there, here also we can have some exceptional case marking. Ram believes himself to be, as in the case of I want Mary to behave herself, Ram believes himself to be super intelligent. I've told you that when the dependent clause is a non-finite, it usually ticks the subject or object of the main clause. Okay? Because believes here is the verb that gives or assigns case to the reflective pronoun himself. So believes gives objective case to himself. So that himself becomes the subject of the non-finite clause. Is that okay? Is that clear?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Ram believes himself to be super intelligent. Again, herself can't be the case because even though it's a non-finite clause, it belongs to the main clause. That means both take the same noun phrase. Himself, again, herself doesn't agree to Ram. This doesn't agree in gender to Ram, so we'll take himself. Now anapher. Second class of anaphers are called reciprocals. Reciprocal means reciprocal pronouns. If there are only two, we use each other. If there are more than one other, again here also the action is reflected back to the subject, but here the subject would be more than one. If there are two subjects, we use each other. If there are more than two subjects, we use one another. Okay? Reciprocals just function like reflexes. Only difference is that there are more than one subject. Ram and Ali, here also, that should also agree in person and gender and number to the antecedent. Ram and Ali respect one another. Can we say one another?
No, ma'am.
There are only two people, Ram and Ali. So you have to use each other. Again, the two participants are envious of
each other.
The three countries might fight. Three takes only one, not each. Exceptional case marking. Again, look at this example. They expected each other to win. They expected that each other would win. Let us take the second example. They expected that each other would win. Can it be a
no, ma'am,
acceptable sentence? Because there each other comes as the subject of a finite clause. Even though would win as another clause, it's a subordinate clause, it is a finite clause. Isn't it so?
Yes, ma'am.
Can it have the subject each other?
No, ma'am.
No, it is the object of the main clause. Since the second clause, that is, since the subordinate clause is a finite clause, it can't take each other to be its subject. If it's a non-finite clause, as in the previous example, as in the first example, they expected each other to win. That can be the case because to win is a non-finite clause. It can take the subject of the subject or object of the finite clause. But here, the second one is also a finite clause. So it can have each other to be the subject of it. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Because it's already governed within the other local domain. They expected each other. Each other can denote only they. It is bound within its local domain. It can't, the other clause can't have it as its subject because it's already bound within the local domain of the finite clause. Don't forget that only if it is a finite clause that this principle is applicable. Okay. Is it clear? Now moving on, the third class of anaphors are emphatic reflexives. Again, emphatic reflexives are reflexives used to emphasize their antecedent. They are not used as a reflexive pronoun, rather they are used for emphasis. For example, Mary herself did it, or Mary baked this bread herself. So I used herself to emphasize Mary. The minister himself has come. The teacher herself has told us. If the teacher is a female, you will say the teacher herself has told us. The teacher, if he's a male, you will say that the teacher himself. If they are teachers, you would say the teachers themselves. That's how you use it. That means it should be, it should follow the antecedent. It should agree in person, number, and gender to the antecedent. Only thing is that it is used for emphasis, not as an object. That is the only difference. If it is used as an object, you call it a reflexive pronoun. If it is used to emphasize the antecedent, you call it emphatic reflexives. Is the idea clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Look at examples. Mary baked this bread herself. I heard that the president himself was present on that occasion. Isn't it right? Because in the second sentence, it is again, inflection phrase 2 is again a finite clause. The president himself was present. So himself should reflect the case of the president or the agreement. Himself should agree with the antecedent. Here, it is not I which is the antecedent, but it is the president. Okay, because that is the local domain. That is the local domain for the reflexive or emphatic reflexive himself. Himself comes within the second inflectional phrase. In that second inflectional phrase, the antecedent is president, not I. Again, look at the second. Third one is a wrong construction because I heard that the president myself. It's a wrong construction because it is not bound to its local domain. Because I is part of another inflectional phrase which can't dominate the emphatic reflexive here. That is what the principle A says. That means if it is an anaphor, it must be bound to its local domain. So anaphors can be reflexive, then reciprocal pronouns, and reflexive used in an emphatic sense. I hope it's clear to you.
Yes, ma'am.
Shall we move on to the second? Before that, there is something called anaphor binding. Anaphor binding is binding of an anaphor within its local domain. It's also called a binding. You are binding an anaphor within its local domain. Anaphor, we have seen what all are anaphors. So this process is called a binding. There is something called a bar binding, which is the relationship between move WH expression and its trace. It is non-argument binding. It is an argument binding, but a WH expression is not an argument binding. It doesn't need to agree to person, number, or thing to something. So that's called a bar binding, non-argument binding. Okay, there are two types of binding: a binding, argument binding, and a bar binding. The movement of transfer, WH transformation is an example of a bar binding, non-argument binding. Doesn't need to agree, but here it has to agree to the antecedent in its number, person, and gender. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
And we will see the concept of pronominals before checking the second principle. So we have seen that a pronominal must be free in its local domain. The first one was anaphor must be bound to its local domain. And the second principle was a pronominal must be free in its local domain. So before that, we need to know what are pronominals. So usually pronominals means pronouns, but you can't have all pronouns as pronominals because there are two types of reference. Anyway, binding theory is about reference. Okay, so two types of reference are possible by using pronouns. One is deictic reference and second is anaphoric reference. So we can say that only pronouns that is belonging to anaphoric pronouns can be taken as pronominals. So deictic means you are pointing at individuals at the given situation, especially imperative case. In imperative sentences, you are pointing at individuals at the given situation. So you don't need to refer outside the context because the listener understands whom you are referring to. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
The second case, that is an aphoric reference, you need to tell whom you mean. If I'm simply saying that he has gone, so you won't understand whom I am referring to. Because I need to explain who that he is. That is an anaphoric reference. So I should give you the reference of the pronoun. But in the other case, if I'm just telling you, can you listen? Can you hear me? If I'm just asking you, are you listening? Could you please keep quiet or could you please mute your mic? I'm telling you, you know that whom I am referring to.
Yes, ma'am.
I don't even need to use you. I can simply say, please mute your mic. That is a deictic reference because you know who I am referring to. But in the second case, when I use pronouns, I have to explain that. I have to give the reference also. That is called anaphoric reference. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
This is applicable to third person pronouns because first person and second person are when you refer to yourself as first person and also the plural is also the listener understands. But in the case of third persons, you have to give explanation. Look at the examples. Harish promised that he would bring the books back today. There are two clauses. Look at the first sentence. Harish promised that he would bring the books back today. Whom does that he refer to?
Harish.
Okay. Similarly, Mary alleged that Kim had hit her. Her refers to?
Mary.
Again, the children like their new teacher. Their refers to?
Children.
So, they're all anaphoric reference because you already have the reference in the you have already a noun phrase that gives you the reference. Antecedent is there. So you don't need to get confused because the reference is already given. So all these sentences have pronouns which are used in an anaphoric sense. So you are getting an anaphoric reference from these sentences. I hope now these things are clear. Anaphoric reference and deictic reference.
Yes, ma'am.
Now we are moving on to principle B. This is the principle. The principle B says that it should be free in its local domain. That means it must not have an antecedent within its local domain. Let us take the first one. Harish promised that he would bring the books back today. He refers to Harish. Harish comes in the Is it bound to its local domain? Is he bound to its local domain?
No, ma'am.
No, because from the second clause, we don't get any reference at all. Rather, it takes its reference from the other clause. Isn't it so?
Yes, ma'am.
So this is called a set principle B. That means a pronoun must not have any antecedent within its local domain. Rather, it should take reference from another domain. Let's take the examples. I heard him. Is it a possible construction? I heard him. Does him have any antecedent in that sentence?
No, ma'am.
No, the reference is outside the local domain. But what about the second one? I heard me. Is it a possible construction? No, because if I am using the subject as the object, I have to use the anaphor. Then only the sentence will be correct. Since I have used a pronominal pronoun, I can't have the reference within the context. I have to get the context from outside the local domain. Since it is not possible. The sentence is not correct. It is ungrammatical. Let you despise me. Is it correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, because me has a pronominal. It's a pronominal which has an outside reference. It doesn't have any antecedent within the sentence. Ram saw me in the mirror.
How is this possible?
Is possible. Ram saw him in the mirror. Is it good? If it is correct, if Ram has seen someone else in the mirror. If Ram has seen himself in the mirror, it is not a possible construction. Isn't it so?
Yes,
It's a
ma'am.
reference of him as to some outside person or outside the context, it can be accepted. But here it is not accepted because him can't refer to Ram. So this is the second principle. A pronoun must not have any antecedent. That means it can have reference outside the local domain, but it must not have any reference within the local domain. This is principle B.
Is it the case of diacritic pronouns?
Sorry?
Is it the case of diacritic pronouns like...
Diacritic pronouns, always it has reference outside the context. If I am saying the three, keep quiet, that means you understand it. I don't need to refer. You simply understand it because the reference is outside the context. Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
See, in imperative sentences, you will always see the references outside the context. You understand it rather. Okay, I don't need to refer to who you that mean, who you mean. I don't need to tell you who that you is because you understand it. It is outside the context. I don't need to explain within the sentence who that you is.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. But since himself, see, why this, there is a classification called the pronoun is that even reflexives are kind of pronouns. Okay, each other, they're all pronouns. They all come under the category of pronouns. But we have a separate category of pronominals. That is pronouns, when I, myself, himself, they're all pronouns.
Yes, ma'am.
We have a category of pronouns to show that when pronouns used as a subject or object, it should have different kind of reference, deictic reference or anaphoric reference. But in case of deictic pronouns, the listener understands who it is. But in case of anaphoric pronouns, the reference must be given. Not in the same context, but in an outside context. Either you have to give another sentence or you have to tell that who that person is. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now we will see the empty category PRO. We have already discussed this empty category PRO. There can be different ways this empty category PRO be used. First one is it is said to have a controller rather than an antecedent. We can't say that it always has a controller. Look at the first one. I want Dash to go home. It has a controller because I is controlling the subject of the non-finite because I is the subject of the second clause also because it's a controller.
Yes, ma'am.
But sometimes it can occur without a controller, as in the third and fourth example. To err is human. There is no controller at all. To err is human. Do we have a controller?
No, ma'am.
So there we can say that sometimes it occurs without a controller. So since it doesn't have a governor, it doesn't have any local domain because it's an empty category PRO. It comes only in the special case, non-finite. It comes along with this empty category. I hope you remember non-finite empty category PRO. So it doesn't have any local domain at all. So you can't say that it has a governor because governor is a concept that is associated with finite clauses. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
It doesn't have a governor, but when it has a controller, it occurs outside the minimal inflectional phrase. If you are deriving a reference from outside the context, that should be outside the context. When you have an antecedent, it should be outside the local domain. Okay. Normally, it doesn't need a governor, doesn't need a controller, it doesn't need an antecedent, but if you want to give it a reference, it should come outside the local domain. Okay. So let us take the first two examples. I want Dash to go home. In the second sentence, to go home, I refers to, the reference is to which antecedent or which controller? We don't have the concept of controller. Rather, we don't have the reference, we don't have the concept of antecedent in the case of an empty PRO. Other we can have a controller. So what is the controller for that PRO in the first sentence?
I.
That is, I. That comes outside the local domain. Isn't it so?
Yes, ma'am.
Again, in the second example also, Sita persuaded Ram to change his mind. What is the subject for the second clause, non-finite clause? To change his mind.
Ram.
Ram is the object. But again, you'll see that Ram is outside the local domain. The reference is to a controller outside the local domain. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
So we can see that it can occur without a controller, can occur without a governor, but when it has a controller, what happens is that it follows principle B. What is principle B? What is principle B of the binding theory? Do you remember principle A?
NFR must be bound to its local domain.
What then? What was second principle?
The pronominal free.
Must be free. It must be free. Look at the examples here. Aren't they free? It has reference outside the local domain. So we can say that they kind of follow the second principle.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So is this concept clear?
Yes, ma'am.
I'm going to take some more time. I don't think I'll be able to finish it today. Okay, shall we continue in the next class?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Definitely.
How do you find this?
Sorry, ma'am.
How do you find syntax?
Yes, ma'am. It's a bit tricky,
It's easy to understand. Once you try to understand, it's very easy. Only thing it deals with advanced level grammar. Maybe not even grammar. You are going deep into the structure of sentence.
There are so much to learn. Like if we can't only understand its rules, we have to like go through it.
You don't need to by heart the rules. Too. See, once you understand the conditions, you don't need to by heart it at all. The only problem is if you try to by heart it will be very difficult. But once you understand what are these things and how can you apply these with some examples, it's going to be very easy.
But ma'am, the names, the typical names, they have so much concept is there.
And
there's too much to learn.
You don't need to by heart the definitions. Rather, you can by heart the terms if you find it difficult. Like yes, a pronominal, anaphors, MC command, N command.
Concepts are very simple, but step by step we have to study.
To study these concepts with some examples, so it will be easier.
Especially yes, ma'am. That would be
structure grammar. If you have an example with you, then you will be able to divide it, and you will be able to show your concept. You can show it using an example. That will be
these concepts were present, not entirely in our school days. But to an extent, reflexive and for these were present in our school days. But this is very tricky.
So that's why that is included in our PG because it is advanced level.
Yes, ma'am. Which block is this? I want to go through it and then come back again with any more questions.
This is syntax 5. This is block 5.
Block 5.
See, this is the only block which is a bit confusing. All the other blocks are very easy compared to this.
Yes,
that's
ma'am.
Why I'm taking a lot of time for them. I have taken, I think, 3. This is next. Tomorrow is going to be the 3rd class. In all the other classes, I dealt with only 1 block. But it takes, I knew that this takes some time. Okay, yes, so with me tomorrow. And once I finish it, I'll move on to stylistics. Stylistics is, again, I don't think it's that difficult, but I'll introduce you some important concept. Okay, once I finish it, maybe I'll take a half or 1 hour, maximum half or 1 hour for this to complete. Then after that, I'll introduce you stylistics. I won't be going in detail. Okay, rather I'll be telling you some important concept, how to apply the stylistic features in prose poetry and so on. See, after this chapter, we have a unit which is very important that is often asked for your exams and all. That is negation. It's a very important concept. Okay. I think that is the last unit. This is the fifth unit, and then we have one more unit, that is a negation. Once I finish it, maximum it takes half an hour. Then I'll give you some idea about syntax. Okay. And I hope you will go through other blocks and all. 6, 7, and 8. Language in use 1, 2. They're all very easy.
Yes, ma'am.
Phonology, morphology, and syntax are the things which you might be studying as new. All the rest are easy. Once you read it, you will understand. It's not that difficult at all. Anyway, if you have any doubt, you can ask me. You go through it. Okay. Yes, thank you.
Ma'am. Okay, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Take care.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Take care. Bye.
Thank you, ma'am.
Bye, ma'am.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.